Do you know how on a very thick rope, the kind of rope that you might find on a sailing ship or that you might tow your car when you have a breakdown, a big thick rope like that has many strands and they're twined together to give them strength? Well, I'm imagining that our tradition, our religious tradition, is like one of those. And the tale of that great history that goes right back to our origins is the tale of pulling apart of those strands. And I want to spend a moment with you to do exactly that, to pull apart the many strands and strains of tradition that then eventually, though they still exist, are separate in the world today. The story begins in a somewhat mythological place at the beginning of the book of Genesis with Adam and Eve, one family. And as one family, Genesis tells the story of our family origins, beginning with the great matriarchs and patriarchs like Abraham and Sarah. But early on, there was a split in that family because Abraham had one child with Hagar and one child with Sarah, and that created a split. And Hagar and Ishmael went their own way, were actually expelled from the family, and Ishmael became the patriarch of the Islamic tradition of Muslims. And that tradition, of course, continues to today with Ishmael as their patriarch. So we will separate out that strand, Islam. Now, even this strand today has many individual lines, but that's a whole other story, and we don't have time to get into all of that right now. So the rest of this represents the Hebrew tradition, the Judeo-Christian tradition, with all of the matriarchs and patriarchs right through the book of Genesis and Exodus right through there. And that is a significant part of the Christian tradition. However, when Jesus of Nazareth came along, a Jewish rabbi, peasant, healer, visionary, he was a Jew right to the day he died, and his followers were also Jewish. And so they represent a part of the Jewish tradition, but at a certain point, the split happened. They were pushed out of that tradition, or they went their separate ways. You could tell that story in a number of different ways. But that became, the Hebrew tradition continued, and what became known as the Christian tradition began. And so this strand represents the Jewish tradition, the Hebrew tradition, and as with Islam, there are many strands within the Jewish tradition, and those two could get separated out, but once again, we don't really have time to get into that right now. So all of these strands represent the many strands within the Christian tradition. And think about at the very beginning, in the book of Acts, Acts 2, awe came on all the people, and the Spirit of God was given, and they spoke in many languages, but all understood the gospel of Jesus Christ in their own language. That is the birth of this particular set of strands, the birth of the Christian church. And so those people moved out across Eastern, Western Europe into Asia and brought that tradition to many places. So there was great diversity across that tradition, both theological and also cultural. And so as time went on, the expression of the Christian tradition became diverse and changed. And over a period of about 500 or 600 years, a split started to emerge between Eastern expressions of the Christian tradition and Western expressions of the Christian tradition. And then in the 11th century, that finally kind of came to a boiling point. These differences were based on both theology, so there was controversy over things like the creeds, the Nicene Creed, and how to interpret them and how to understand the person and life of Jesus or the life of the Spirit. But there was also differences around how to live as Christians, how to organize the church. Things like celibacy. The Western Church said priests needed to be celibate. The Eastern Church said, no, that's not the case. That's not necessary. And the Western Church had a ritual meal for communion. The Eastern Church had a real meal with genuine ordinary bread. And there were many other around baptism and other things that created a split. And at that point, the Western Church and the Eastern Church split in the 11th century. And that's what this strand represents, is the Eastern tradition, the Eastern Orthodox tradition. There are, once again, a number of strands connected with that tradition, but that's more of a story than we have a chance to talk about now. So this set of strands now represents the Western Christian Church, what was known then as the Roman Catholic Church. The Eastern Church had a patriarchy that gave it its political structure. The Western Church was led by Rome and by a pope. And that tradition carried on through the Middle Ages, through up until the 16th century. But in Western Europe, many things were changing. Things you can think about, the invention of the printing press gave language in printed form into the hands of people in their own languages. So up until then, Latin had been the kind of Roman language, including the biblical language and the language of worship. But once the 16th century comes along, people are wanting to worship in their own language, wanting to gain access to the scriptures and read in their own language. There were also theological differences and differences of practice. The big one was called the paying of indulgences. How is it that we, in the language of the time, go to heaven? How do we stay united with God? How do we achieve salvation? And at the time, if you were worried about your recently deceased person, the church would offer prayers, but not equally. If you paid them an indulgence, they would offer a special mass for your person, and that would get them closer to God. Well, people had issues with that, the paying of indulgences, and so eventually there were a number of reforms that were called for, were not given, and the Protestant Reformation emerged. Think about Luther, Martin Luther, and his 95 theses. Those were 95 changes he wanted to see, and eventually he was pushed out of the Roman Catholic Church. So this split right here, the most significant split in the Western Church in history, happened, and many strands emerged from the Roman Catholic Church. So this strand represents the Roman Catholic Church, which continues today, of course, all over the world. Many strands in it. And this set of strands represents what's called the Reformed tradition, born at the Reformation. So the many strands of the Reformed tradition largely are characterized by nationalities, like as people from Europe moved around the world, different streams of Reformed tradition came to life in different parts of the world. So, for example, in Europe, there was some idealists called radical reformers, and people like Mennonites and Anabaptists, who became Baptists as we know them today, had some strong ideals about how we should live our Christian life, and that became a stream within the Reformed tradition. There were in Scotland, there was John Knox, who was a kind of a wild character, a wild reformer, and he gave birth to the Presbyterian, Scottish Presbyterian tradition, which then translated across the world in various other Presbyterian traditions. There were the Lutherans, and Lutherans coming mostly out of Germany, but spreading into a lot of Western Europe. And we know there are a number of strains of Lutherans that eventually also came to North America. And in England, the Reformation took an interesting turn in England, because partly it happened because of political reasons. King Henry VIII and his many wives, and there was differences of opinion as to whether or not that was allowed, and eventually he took the English Catholic Church out of the Roman Catholic Church for really personal political reasons. But the same energy of Reformation existed within the church at that point. And at a certain point, with John Wesley, following John Wesley, the Methodist tradition emerges. In Methodist tradition, it's called the Methodist tradition because Wesley had a method of Christian discipleship, and that gave rise to the name the Methodists, and eventually they too were pushed out of the Anglican Church and became a Reformed tradition in and of themselves. Many other strands under the umbrella of Reformed Church emerged. Think about Christian Reform, Dutch Reform, and other kind of Reformed names. One of those being the Congregationalist Church. So a Congregationalist Church is a church that has most of its decisions based in a congregation, not in some larger organization. Well, they moved to North America and moved across North America, including in Canada. And that's what all of these different strains represent. The United Church of Christ in the States, the Christian Reformed Church, the Disciples of Christ, and Congregationalist churches. In more recent times, in around the turn of the 19th to 20th century, there came a new movement within the Christian church called the ecumenical movement. What people saw in North America was that much of their lives were lived together with other people from other churches. You can see all of the many diversity of churches that would be in existence in any given town. And people would go to school together and work together and be in business together and organize themselves in town council together, and they would curl together and they would play hockey together. But on Sunday, they would separate and go to their own churches. At a certain point, that didn't make sense to some people. They thought, why are we not together on Sunday as well? Sunday should not be a divided day. And so the ecumenical movement emerged to bring churches together. And in Canada, that happened in the expression of the United Church of Canada. United from originally three different streams. From the Presbyterian Church, and it came together with the Methodist Church, and it united with the Congregationalist Church. And in 1925, turned back to one strand, the United Church of Canada. And eventually, the Disciples of Christ were added and became part of that one strand of Reformed Church called the United Church of Canada, which has been in existence since 1925 and exists till today.